Welcome back to The Lifestyle Show with me, Pam Joseph, live here at the Ben TV Studios in London. I am in the presence of His Excellency, the High Commissioner to Jamaica, Mr. Seth George Ramakan. May I say, it's a pleasure.
The pleasure is mine. Great to be here.
I know your schedule is so busy, sir.
Certainly
so thank
is.
Thank you ever so much
yes.
for giving us this time.
Yes.
We have asked our viewers to pose their questions in, and later on, the phone lines are going to be open, sir, if
okay.
you don't mind.
All right.
And, you know, they're going to be vetted, but the phone lines will be open, you know, to pose any questions they may have.
Sure.
For you.
Sure.
Also, some of you have actually emailed, and I have those there. But let's start off with the beginning, sir.
Yes.
Thank you ever so much. November 2016.
Yes.
You was appointed.
Yes.
Yes. This was announced officially.
Yes, yes,
in November.
It was.
Yes,
yes,
yeah, okay.
Yes.
That didn't come as a shock to you?
It didn't, because for a number of months prior, the discussions, you know, had been taking place. Mm-hmm. You may be aware that before that I was in Toronto and served there for a period of 5 years.
Yes, you did.
And then later, you know, the government of Jamaica thought it
prudent.
Fit to yeah. ask me to serve
yeah.
here in the UK. The UK.
Yeah.
However, you know, the documentation and all that
mm.
did take quite some time.
Yes.
And I know that there were a number of persons wondering, well, why is there such a vacancy?
Mm-hmm.
But there is a process, and that process really sometimes take a little bit of
yeah.
Time, both on the side of the United Kingdom,
mm-hmm.
and of course, this after Jamaica has
yes.
made the proposal to the United Kingdom,
yes,
they have
yes.
to do their due diligence.
Indeed,
and so
indeed,
that is part
indeed.
Of it. But indeed. So happy to be here. I came on the 22nd of December.
December? You
yes,
flew in,
yes,
and this is it.
Yes.
How has it been so far, sir?
Great, from day one, 22nd of December,
yeah.
I didn't go to the residence, I went to the office.
Ah. Oh my
and
God.
Started the work
You're
there.
Keen?
Oh, right on, and didn't leave there until late in the night. Because I know I was overdue, and there's a lot of work, and there's
of
a lot of backup.
Yes, yes.
You know, there were invitations to so many, you know, events, both official and community events.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I just wanted to see how we could play catch up here.
Yeah.
And got quite a bit done.
It must be said that not only are you, you know, the in resident High Commissioner here, but you're also non-resident High Commissioner to Ireland, Finland, Cyprus, Denmark, Norway, and Sweden. And not a lot of people know that.
That is correct.
That is a huge remit.
It is huge. You know, we do not have ambassadors in all countries.
Of course.
And therefore, regionally, being posted here to the United Kingdom,
yeah.
these are the countries to which I'm accredited.
Yes.
And so what we do have and seek to have are honorary consuls located in these locations.
Mm.
And I do occasional visits
yes.
there. We do try to find, as our honorary consuls, persons, as a word would denote, these are persons who are of influence, who are outstanding in their communities,
mm-hmm.
Who have the sort of connections with our community
yes.
in these countries, are willing to serve the role of a consular services.
Yes.
And of course, to be of some influence in helping us to seek out investments, helping to build tourism
mm.
is quite a task.
Mm. Yeah, it is.
Quite a task, but I do relate to these countries in that way. So
yeah.
I should be paying official visits to these countries
yeah.
in the near future.
In the near future. I would say that you are the right person for the job, because you first have mentioned to the viewers that you also were the High Commissioner in Toronto. But you've got quite a bit.
Consul General.
Consul General.
In Toronto.
I must say that.
Yes.
Consul General,
yes.
Yeah. But you hold a Master of Arts in Interdisciplinary Studies
yes.
with special focus on counselling psychology.
Yes, that is
Now
great.
That sounds rather deep.
Yes.
Can you explain to me?
Well, you know, in my pastoral work, because I am a pastor.
Now you keep getting me over.
Yes.
Because I want to get... I would like to say that. You are an ordained pastor.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, my work takes in not only biblical studies, you know, sermons, things of this nature.
Yes.
But also the area of dealing with people.
Yes.
And the issues that arise,
a
spiritual work is also requires mm-hmm. that one attend to the physical needs and cares and issues affecting people in their lives.
Yes, yes.
And so my study in counseling psychology serves that purpose.
Of course.
It helps me to be able to relate to people, to discover just where they are at, to meet them at their point of need, to be able mm-hmm. to identify with their issues, to be able to find ways of helping them cope with whatever issues they're facing. And mm-hmm. so a part of this has to do with family counseling, like in marriage mm-hmm. and family. Mm-hmm. It has to do with personal development mm-hmm. and things of this nature. So mm-hmm. I do have a span of things that I have to relate to individuals on. And so I do that both in pastoral work and outside of pastoral work.
Pastoral work as well. You're former vice chairman and interim executive director of the Heart Trust.
Yes.
Talk to us about
the Heart Trust. Is the agency in Jamaica, Heart Human Employment Resource Training. Mm-hmm. And it has to do with training in the vocational areas. The vocational areas were not as emphasized. We had the academic or universities.
Uh-huh.
And so there was that tier of persons who are very skilled, are very knowledgeable in particular fields, whether it is in electronics, whether it is in carpentry mm-hmm. or masonry or, mm-hmm. you know, all these various mm-hmm. skills. But mm-hmm. certainly they needed to have a particular international standard qualification
mm.
so that they can also participate in overseas employment
right
and
on.
Things of this nature.
Yes,
and so HEART provides that kind of training
Excellent.
And certification
Excellent.
For individuals.
Yeah.
It has to do with, you know, the area of hospitality, for example,
yes.
which is in our tourist industry.
Yeah.
And so it serves our nation well in terms of providing skilled and qualified technicians, if you may, mm-hmm. in the area of work. HEART is the largest institute of its kind in the English-speaking Caribbean.
Excellent.
And it has gone beyond its borders in order to collaborate with similar institutes in other islands in order to help develop
wow.
that vocational area. It,
yeah.
it offers tertiary level training as well. So
yeah.
it goes from about post high school, or you could even say mid high school, because we actually offer an extra 2 years of training in the high schools
Ooh.
So that a child will not graduate without employable qualifications. And that's very, very important.
Yeah, that is important. That's important indeed.
Yes, yes.
Excellent. Former executive director for the Jamaica Institute for Political Education.
Yes.
Again.
Yes.
It's almost in conjunction with what you were saying about further education,
the young ones. And that is a very important area. Jamaica is a very strong democracy. We have shown regard and respect for the political process, and our two major political parties
mm-hmm.
Have served us well in perpetuating that
mm-hmm.
That democratic tradition.
Yeah.
Our parliament, you know, is made up of both the opposition and the government, and even at the Senate level.
Mm-hmm.
There is both an opposition and government representation
yes.
to the extent
mm-hmm.
that in 1983
mm-hmm.
when one of the parties decided to decline not to participate in the elections, the elected party decided to appoint independent senators,
yes.
in order to serve the purpose of that bicameral tradition. And so it has worked very well.
Yes.
Institute of Political Education was sponsored by the Konrad Adenauer Foundation of West Germany. The German political system, alongside the parties, have foundations. And these foundations help to promote the ideology, if you may, of the party, and to ensure that the party is not just in spirit, it is also in fact, it is also in research.
Yes,
and
yes,
so that's a kind of the research arm. And this was of the Jamaica Labour Party. The Jamaica Institute of Political Education was aligned to. So quite a bit of work was done in promoting the value of democracy and helping people to contend with ideas rather than in the streets with, you know, violently trying to overcome each other.
Which was part
of the reason, because we did have an experience in our political system where there was a lot of, you know, violent activity. And having lifted it to the area of contending with ideas rather than with each other physically, you know, over what we believe, was an important transition to make. And I think it served the whole political system well.
Yeah.
On the other hand, apart from the Konrad Adenauer Foundation, was the Frederick Ebert Stiftung, which is also the foundation on which is more, you may say, the liberal side. The Konrad Adenauer Foundation is the conservative side. And so you had both foundations in Jamaica working with the two political parties, and that I think was a great development.
You're also a founding member of the Eastern Caribbean Institute for Democracy and the Caribbean Youth Conference.
Yes. ECID, also founded by the Konrad Adenauer Foundation, and along with the relationship with the Jamaica Labour Party at that time in Jamaica, who had developed the relationship with the Konrad Adenauer Foundation, and thought that we should not keep this find to ourselves, that we should be able to assist, you know, our neighbors, the neighboring islands in the Caribbean, to also benefit from this. This support that the Konrad Adenauer Foundation was giving. So the Eastern Caribbean Institute for Democracy was founded, and the purpose of that was to help build political leaders in the region. And I'm very, very happy to say that it did happen that, for example, I think three, for sure, Keith Mitchell was one of Grenada, who was part of ECID and emerged, you know, as the Prime Minister of Grenada.
Yeah, indeed.
There was Stevenson King,
again. St. Lucia,
who actually became Prime Minister.
Yeah.
And he was, before that,
You
know, a member of ECID.
Oh.
So, you know, I think that it has served a very, very, you know, tangible, provided tangible results, that the work that was done through ECID and through the Caribbean Youth Conference, of course, that was also part of it, you know, helping the much younger folks to get an understanding of the civil side of politics, that politics is there to serve people and not for acquiring power to oneself. So that, you know, was sort of the kinds of lectures, the kinds of engagement and discussions that took place that I think has brought forth the kind of fruits we are talking about.
This is brilliant, absolutely brilliant. You've got an Associates of Science degree in business administration. Now, now, obviously, this is why you are who you are today.
Yes.
Where did you study that, sir?
That was at the what is now known as Northern Caribbean University in Jamaica. It was then known as West Indies College, and it's a Seventh-day Adventist college that teaches not only religious subjects, but all the subjects, including, you know, in the sciences and in the area mm-hmm. of business. Mm-hmm. And I actually got my training there and have found it to be very useful in the
You know, I would have thought that you would have gone into be sort of like a professor, gone into the sort of teaching mold, you know, to the heights of professor. Why did you turn into politics?
You know, I think that the whole aim of any kind of, whether it's teaching or business or so, mm-hmm. you do need a stable environment in which to operate. Mm-hmm. And at the time when I entered politics in Jamaica, Jamaica was kind of at a crossroads. Mm-hmm. I think we were, to some extent, experimenting with ideological, mm-hmm. You know, beliefs, and there emerged alliances that we thought might not have been, and that is now from, you know, the party perspective, were not in line with what Jamaica was about. Mm. I saw that, and jumped up, and that's a story by itself.
Yeah.
You know, I could tell you how it all happened.
Yeah.
But I got into the political fray and you know, decided to be a part of it. It was at a very young age.
You wasn't happy with what was going on. Is that what you're saying to me?
It.
You wasn't, and
that
you felt you could make a difference.
I thought I had to be a part of
right
the change, if you may.
Yeah.
And for that reason, I got involved and did serve. I served from 1980-81. All the way up to 96. That was the span of service in politics before I began my sort of pastoral work,
right,
which in itself is another kind of
another way you moved again over there,
yes,
and then you came right back in it again.
Yes,
but
well,
this time even
in the role of the High Commissioner.
Yes,
and this is a very important role, and this is what I would hope we could spend more of our time talking a little bit about.
Yes.
Serving, you know, the role of the diplomatic role that I'm in. This year, having come here, it's a very significant year. It's the 55th year of Jamaica's independence. And there are many things that are working together in this one 55th year.
Yes.
Because I really want, as High Commissioner, to lay some groundwork.
Yes.
I should be here for 4 years. And I really want to you know, lay a kind of groundwork in this first year.
Yeah.
And the 55th year provides that opportunity.
Oh, of course it does.
So what we are doing, the first thing that's going to be happening is that we are having a Jamaica 55 Diaspora Conference.
Mm-hmm.
The Jamaica 55 Diaspora Conference is a very significant moment that is going to be serving, you know, maybe the next 4 years of work,
of course.
Because members of the diaspora mm-hmm. will be coming to Jamaica and speaking about the UK, of Jamaican UK diaspora, the citizens will be coming to Jamaica mm-hmm. in order to participate in the program. It's going to be over 4 days, from the 23rd of July to the 27th of July. And it's going to be this place where the meeting of the minds is going to be, this place where the input from Jamaicans living overseas will have their part to play, because they have been playing a tremendous role,
but not enough. You're saying
I would say that there is more that can be done.
On.
I think it's been a tremendous support in terms of our health sector, in terms of our education sector, in terms of communities, development of communities, individuals, in terms of relating to their families.
Yes.
Had it not been for the work of the Jamaican diaspora, we would have been way behind. And at the same time, we are seeing that with more work from the diaspora, we can be way ahead.
That's right.
Because Jamaica does not see its diaspora as, you know, another body out there. Mm-hmm. It's part of Jamaica. Yeah. We regard our diaspora as the extension, the global presence of Jamaica. Mm-hmm. And for that reason, there are so many things that that can be done. I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. Jamaica has relationships with the countries in which it has its diaspora.
Yeah.
The persons in that community, mm-hmm. many of them are persons in very high offices, whether it's business or it's in the professions or it's in government. Mm-hmm. There are persons of Jamaican heritage mm-hmm. Who occupy very significant roles and know many of the persons that we are seeking as a country mm-hmm. to engage in order to make probably
develop.
Negotiate or create policies of sorts.
Yes.
So this is really an important place that the diaspora mm-hmm. is not just living in a country, they also can be ambassadors.
Yeah.
For Jamaica, even beyond what a high commissioner can do. Mm-hmm. A high commissioner is an official ambassador.
Yes, yes.
But in terms of effectiveness, you can find that persons who are citizens of the country and are critical players in the country's affairs can have a greater impact and role.
Yeah,
and so we want to engage, and we have been engaging these persons. But then they need to know what Jamaica is doing. They need to understand what some of the policies are. Yeah. They need to be able to speak with the authorities in Jamaica. And that's what the Diaspora Conference is all about.
Yeah.
It's about the engagement and the exchange of ideas and the consensus that we can build mm-hmm. in order to determine how we will go forward. Mm-hmm. Jamaica has its objective of becoming a developed country mm-hmm. by the year 2030. And what that means is that we have to attain to all the standards that a developed country has.
Yes.
And what better opportunity you have than having members of the Jamaican heritage living across, in countries where there is, you know,
this is how busy the High Commissioner
this
is.
You know, this phone was turned off.
This is how busy the High
And would you believe it is actually turned off? And he decided not to.
It was turned off.
And I'm going to be doing this right here on your show.
Yeah, no worries. This is live.
I have witnesses
what happens.
To show that at the door I did turn off my phone.
That's excellent. Yeah. But you know what? What we do, we're going to leave it there for a moment because we're going to take a break.
Yes.
Your Excellency, we're going to take a break.
Yes.
And at this point, you're going to come back more with this event, this huge and very important event.
Yes.
Tell us a bit more. But we're also going to say to you at home that phone lines are going to be open now. 020-8808-0693. 020-8808-0693. Make that call. He's sitting right here.
Good.
Okay, we'll see you soon.
For any professional live streaming production of any event in the UK, Ben TV Livestream are here to serve and provide you with the global coverage you need anywhere at real time. We are offering a deal to accommodate the local events. Just send us an email for more information at livestream@bentelevision.com or call us on 020-8808-8800. Ben TV, Sky 182, bridging the gap.
To the Lifestyle Show. Phone's going off. This is live. So you know we're live. I told you we're live, didn't I? His Excellency is going to continue with this very important event that's going to be taking place in the summer. But before that, just give you that number again. to call through, you can actually speak to His Excellency live here in the studio, 0208 808 0693. But Your Excellency, please continue this huge and important event.
So what we want to do is to invite persons to just take that decision and to be in Jamaica for this conference. You'll find that it's not only edifying and in terms of an opportunity for strong networking and to get to know the players in the Jamaican business community, in the political community of Jamaica, but it's also a time when you can take a break and look for relatives, look for friends.
Yeah.
So you can do many, many things, while you're there.
Well. Yeah.
And so July 23 to 27 is a conference. Mm. And, you know, there's a whole program, just call in to the Jamaica High Commission.
Yeah.
You know, I just don't have the number out of my head. Here, I should have taken it with me, but I gave a card.
Yeah, we're going to give out the number before you leave
That's
us.
That's right.
Yeah.
And and we can really update you on just, you know, what the requirements, or send you some information by email.
Yeah.
Once you call in and you request it, we can just send you an email package giving you all the information about the conference. But this is very, very critical. Now, alongside the conference, we're having the 55 celebrations here in the UK.
Yes.
And this is going to be really a celebration beyond the ordinary. First of all, at the foundation of this celebration, we are planning on compiling a book which is going to be featuring...
You make it sound so thick. This is like an album.
That's right. We're going to be featuring about 500 Jamaican UK citizens who have reached the top of the ladder of their professions or their careers or their, you know, what area of endeavor, whether it's in politics or it's in business or so.
Yeah.
And to be able to show not only their achievements, but how they have impacted to the well-being of the United Kingdom.
Yeah, and others. And
others. That is correct.
Yes,
and so this is going to be really good. And why is this important?
Brilliant.
It's important because in the UK in particular, there are at least four generations of persons of Jamaican heritage. There are those who came, then their children, then their children's children, then their great-grandchildren, right? And so these persons who are what we would call the second, third, and fourth generation need to have a legacy to show that, you know, what their parents did. To have it on record.
Yes.
Because sometimes there are some negative connotations, you know, about a community probably created by one or two wrongdoers. And we, you know, it's important to report the crashes, but the safe landings, you know, of
the thousands of people
who are doing extraordinarily well
Excellent.
And are making a significant contribution to the well-being of the United Kingdom.
Yes.
This ought to be known,
yes,
and it ought to be known also by the children of these those who came first.
Exactly.
And for that reason, we'll be compiling that, and we are going to be needing persons to write into us and to suggest persons, because maybe we're not thinking of everybody.
Yeah.
So we would like for you to share with us persons who you think should make this list.
Right.
And of course, that will be looked at by a committee in order to determine
Excellent.
Where it's going to go.
On that note, Your Excellency, we've got our first caller, and it's a male. I'm glad it is a male. Andrew. Andrew, hello there. You're through to Lifestyle. How are you, sir?
Morning.
Can I hear you, Andrew? Are you
with
me?
Yeah, morning.
Hello, Andrew.
Morning.
Hello there. Morning to you, sir.
I just want to ask the High Commissioner, is the conference, the diaspora conference, does it take place in London only, or does it take place in Jamaica? And does the government give any assistance for people who want to go? Thank you.
Very good question. The Jamaica Diaspora Conference takes place in Jamaica, in Kingston, at the Jamaica Conference Center. Now, we will be here in the UK, be having a conference, a local conference, But this is sort of a preparatory exercise for those who will be going to the conference in order for us to do some preliminary work in terms of participation, roles that individuals will play, because there'll be a number of panels, there will be a number of presentations, and we are right at this moment looking at, four persons who will participate at that level.
Okay.
So a full program, for example, will be shared with the persons who indicate their interest in going to the conference,
right,
so that they can have an understanding of what will be covered at the conference.
Yes.
And then we will have a meeting prior to the conference in order to be able to share and to engage and to be able to organize, so to speak, ourselves from the UK before we land there in Jamaica.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of the government assisting, no, the government is not able to pay for persons to come to the conference. They, of course, at the conference there are lots of expenses the government does cover, and covers along with a number of partners from the business community in Jamaica. The facilities, the lunches that are provided, the many other things that have to be done at a conference that does cost. So the government actually puts on the conference, but the persons who would like to come to the conference would organize to make it there, to provide their airfares and so on. There are special rates that have been negotiated with hotels around the Kingston area,
that's good, special
and
rates.
Therefore, there are preferred rates being offered to persons who are coming to the conference by these hotels. These kinds of details can be had when the persons write in. We'll send them an email which could sort of fill out the details for them.
Okay, I'm going to start with the emails as we wait for others' calls to come through. In no particular order, Your Excellency, I'm going to start with a lady by the name of Marcia from Dalston, that's in the east part of London.
Yes.
She asks, how can this new government turn the negativity Jamaica holds in some international quarters when it comes to business, investment and tourism?
Okay, negativity... are not necessarily in those particular areas. I think if I were to speak of negativity in those areas, it might be, the bureaucratic experience that some people go through in order to get that business going, or in order to give, gifts to Jamaica, whether to the health sector or education sector. So that may be. But in terms of the tourist industry, Jamaica has an extraordinarily vibrant tourist industry that has claimed international awards. Just in December, there were several international awards, that Jamaica was able to attract because of its strong tourism product. Maybe a little more detail. I'm sure the person would have, if the person were online, would sort of spell out a little bit more. Yes, than that. But for example, Jamaica has one of the highest percentage of return tourists. Once you come to Jamaica, this is why we have the phrase, once you go, you know. Because people really come back to Jamaica once they have been to Jamaica.
Yeah, like
the thing is to make that first visit. And we guarantee you that, close to half of those persons are going to be back in Jamaica over and over.
Yeah.
And sometimes what draws people to come back to Jamaica are their children. When they come to Jamaica on their vacations, their children enjoy it so much that the children say, no, mommy, no, daddy, I don't want to go anywhere. Let's go to Jamaica, because that's the place to go.
Yeah.
So we find that that is going very well. But I would have loved to have a little more detail of the particular negative areas.
I will admit it, my daughter went to Jamaica for the first time last year. So much so, she's booked a ticket again for this year.
Now you think about that.
Now, that's, I got to say that.
Okay.
So that's the truth.
Oh,
First time last year, she's 24.
Yes.
And she immediately, when she came back, she already booked for this year. So you've just said what you said, and I believe that. Cynthia from Kent asks, I was in Jamaica recently and I realised many of the industrial workers seem to come from other islands or even overseas. Why aren't we employing our own?
We do employ our own primarily, but there are persons who come to Jamaica maybe because of a shortfall in that particular area of skill. And so, you know, persons would probably come there. There are persons, though, who live in Jamaica. They're not just come to Jamaica for a job. They come there to live. Yeah. And for that reason, you know, they need to work in Jamaica.
Yes, of course.
The fact is that Jamaica has long been a multicultural society. That is why our motto is out of many, one people. We've always had this tradition of a wide range of nationalities, of persons, of cultures in Jamaica. It's a grand mix. And I think that is one of the credits that can be paid to Jamaica for having that broad level of tolerance for people, no matter their background, or their race, culture. You know, Jamaica is really that place. Yeah. And it has demonstrated this over many, many years.
Yes.
Intermarriages, you know, in Jamaica is so strong that people are of all hue and color, are there, and so sometimes you'll see even some of our contestants in the Miss World and the Miss Universe. You know, you can see it's really a blend here, you know, of nationalities.
Yes, yes.
I've often, you know, taken note of that. So it really is a wonderful country,
and
that's probably why you see.
I must tell you, when I worked for a radio station, I was asked by the Jamaica Tourist Board at the time.
Yes.
There was a lot of us. We went over to Jamaica. What we specialised in was looking at and highlighting small-run, family-run. Family-run.
Yes.
Hotels.
Okay, yes. Businesses. That is right.
And because what they felt was that it was all well and good to go into a resort and just stay in there for the 2 weeks, but you're not looking at the islands.
Absolutely.
You know? So it was rather interesting. So my boss sent me off and said, we'll go along.
Yes.
And I loved it.
Yes, wow.
But what I loved was those small run family.
Yes.
Because it was so intimate.
It's like home.
It
it's really home.
Lovely.
Yes.
It was professionally run, don't get me wrong.
Yes.
But it was intimate and it was really nice. And you can walk onto the streets and you could get a transport and you know, you can get involved, and I loved it.
Yes.
I've got to say that.
Yes.
And I
when
think there should be more of that being highlighted instead of sandals and all this lot. Sorry to say that. No, but it's always about the big resorts, but, you know.
It's a wide range, and that is a very important part of the product, the tourism product. And when you come to Jamaica, you do not feel like a stranger. You feel like a family member in Jamaica because of the way you are treated, because of the way people just naturally relate to you, because of the way people do not look at you and think that you are some strange person.
Right.
You feel that you fit in to Jamaica. And this, I think, has a lot to do with the tradition over a long period of time, which, you know, another program could be spoken about. Because Jamaica really upholds, you know, has a very strong and long record in building, you know, not only relations, but for human rights over many, many years. And that's something that in itself is a topic. I did a presentation recently on this, Jamaica's unique role in the world, showing the tradition of Jamaica's human rights record, how it has always advocated for people, the rights, whether no matter who they are, you know, but people ought not to be oppressed or in place of disadvantage. And of course, you know, that is something that we are very conscious of, both locally and internationally. Exactly. And it's something that can be spoken about at some other time.
Excellent. Okay, Michael from Shepherd's Bush asks, how is your government helping to encourage the third generation born in the UK of Jamaican heritage to bring their specialised skills to the island? Wow. Should I say?
Spot on. I love that question. That is really weird. Absolutely. Yeah. Do you know, in this year, in our 55th anniversary, one of the things I deliberately did in consultation with the leaders within the communities is for us to take an intentional decision for the second, third, fourth generation to be brought to the fore in the leadership of the Jamaica 55 celebrations.
Yeah.
So that the first generation that has done such a tremendous job in building a legacy for their children, rather than waiting for their children just to voluntarily come on over and take over after they have gotten too old, to engage them while they are still active. And so this is one of the ways in which the second and third generation need to be to come in. There's a lot of work being done at the youth level. There's Jamaicans Inspired that is doing a tremendous work. There are other youth kind of programs that through the diaspora that are going on. Just get in touch with us at the High Commission.
We are
eagerly awaiting your call.
Well, Your Excellency, let's see if this caller, Winston, has something to say on that. Hello, Winston, you are through to Lifestyle.
Good morning, His Excellency. How are you doing today, sir?
Good morning. Good to hear you.
Yes, thank you, sir. It's an honour to speak to you. What I wanted to know is recently I've heard that Jamaica has surpassed the rest of the Caribbean in terms of tourism and hotel industry, because I'm in places like Barbados and St. Lucia. Just wanted to know, what do you believe is the reason behind that, such a great leap that has been taken recently?
Well, I think a lot of it is because we regard tourism as a very major player in the building of Jamaica, as a critical industry. And so we have given a lot of priority to the building of our tourism product. But a tourism product is not built except the people are attuned to it, except the people are in support of that product. And I believe that the real reason tourism does so well in Jamaica is because of its people. The people who regard, when you come to Jamaica, people feel, just as I was saying, they do not feel as though they are just visitors or strangers. They feel that they have come home, you know. And for that reason, they come back again. And I think that is part of what makes Jamaica great at tourism. If it were that people are visiting and they say, okay, I've been there, let me go some other place, you know, then it may not have been the same. But when they've been there, they say, wow, I need to come back. And not only that, they make friends in Jamaica. I know that. I know that when they come to Jamaica and they begin to meet people, they have built such warm friendships and relationships that they come back to Jamaica, not just for their vacation, but to look for their friends. You know, so that is part of what is happening here, you know, with tourism in Jamaica. Apart from that, Jamaica is described as a continent in a country, in a small island. It has a feeling of a continent because Jamaica is not just a flat piece of land. You know, Jamaica is a place of mountains and valleys and hills and the terrains, and it has to do with the vegetation, the topography, the beaches. You know, you get into Jamaica and you're just discovering that, wow, this place is so interesting, you know, in terms of for its size. And apart from that, you know, Jamaica is a global player. Not only, you know, the pun, you know, player in terms of games, but in terms of many other things. For example, just in 2012, the National Geographic magazine carried an article. It did a survey around the world of the most popular national dishes. Now just think of this. And the second most popular national dish in the world is ackee and saltfish.
I said, don't say that ackee and saltfish, and he said ackee and saltfish.
It is, it is.
Oh my God.
And would you believe
and I love ackee
that
saltfish.
The number one is hamburger? Now, look, just think about it. When you think of what it takes for hamburger to be number one, because it takes billions of dollars with a McDonald's, it takes through Burger King and all this kind of promotion.
And then imagine,
how did Ackee and Saltfish make it to number two? Now that's the phenomenon of Jamaica.
Said.
And I say no more.
For real. And I just had some yesterday.
Yes.
let me read the last one here. No, actually, it's not the last one, but Sonia from Hertfordshire asks, with President Trump now in power, do you think some of his quirky policies will have a negative impact on Jamaica's trade with the US?
No, that's a question you're asking. I will not make any remarks on the quirkiness
really
or anything of that nature. But you know, countries have their rights to make their decisions, to make their policies, and it is our hope that the United States will be continuing with the kind of policies that has endeared it to the world.
Yes.
The world recognizes the United States as a great player in the international politics and relations.
Mm-hmm.
And it brings us a balance, you know, to the various very extreme forms of government across the world.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are hoping that this will be the continued by President Trump. It matters not whether it is the Republican or the Democratic Party is in office in the United States. We have always had a sort of continuum.
Yeah.
And we are hoping that this is going to be the case and look forward to it.
And I look forward to
it.
Okay. Last but not least, Jennifer from Harlow asks, how is the government protecting returnees? What initiatives have been put in place to see no harm comes
from? Look, returnees are Jamaicans.
Mm-hmm.
We make sure before they return that we confirm their identity. They are citizens of Jamaica, and Jamaica cares for our returnees as much as we care for all of our people. We believe that, and have been seeking to work with those who are returned to Jamaica to find out the best ways. They have a life. They have lived a life.
Mm-hmm.
They know what they want.
Right.
So these are not children who you're making decisions for.
That's right.
These are persons you are engaging in order to get you know, the best opportunities for them. I must say, in credit to the British government, there have been supporting and providing different kinds of whether it's by way of funding for accommodation for persons who have returned, who have no other source, or it is for helping persons to begin their life in Jamaica.
Yeah.
There is some support there for that kind of thing. There's a counseling program for persons who are returning to Jamaica. Now, let me put it this way. Not all persons who return to Jamaica are dependents
or
in a disadvantaged position.
Yeah.
They came to this country, probably overstayed their visit and ran afoul with the law, the immigration law, and have returned to Jamaica. They already know what they are doing. So, you know, quite a number of persons are in that. The persons we are mostly concerned about are persons who return and they are probably suffering peculiar illnesses that makes it difficult for them to integrate.
Yeah.
Persons who return to Jamaica, but they've been here, came here as children and don't know relatives and don't know have any family. Those are the persons that we you know, we are really reaching out to and working with. There are many agencies through the churches and through social agencies that reach out to persons who are returned to Jamaica.
Yeah.
And therefore, if you know of anyone who has returned to Jamaica and is in Jamaica and is, you know, just not receiving that kind of treatment or attention, you know, please bring it to our attention. You know, we are very, very eager to do that. You know, I've been to the remand centers, where the number of the persons earmarked for deportation have been, to sit, to meet, to talk with them, to understand what their experience has been, to find out if all the options that are they're entitled to for legitimizing their stay in the UK, if those options have been utilized or are exhausted. For a person to be returned to Jamaica, it's not just what many people have been saying, that, you know, they are seen and they're just picked up and then they're put on a plane. No, there's a process. The Vienna Convention requires that, first of all, it's reported to the High Commission.
Of course.
And the High Commission is required to confirm whether this person is a person of a Jamaican citizen. And if it is, then the person is treated with the respect that they deserve as a citizen. And at the same time, we are very strong on the view that Jamaica believes in the rule of law. The rule of law in its country, Jamaica, the rule of law in the United Kingdom. And we do not support our citizens who break the laws of the United Kingdom.
Indeed.
We are strongly opposed to that and encourage anyone, any person, a Jamaican citizen here who would wish to stay in the United Kingdom to pursue the legitimate course of doing so. That is something I want to emphasize. We are not out there in any way supporting or compromising the breaking of the law, not at all.
Of course, of course. Yes, you know what? You could probably stay with me for the 2 hours because it seems like this 2 hours would have gone and you wouldn't even realize it.
Isn't that right?
I'm telling you, we do have.
I do have a lot more.
I know. We can do this again.
I look forward to
time.
It.
We really could.
Yes.
Thank you ever so much.
The pleasure is mine.
Thank you ever so much.
Thank you so much. You've been very gracious in accommodating me here.
Thanks
to your listeners, your viewers, your audience.
Excellent.
For actually listening to us this morning. I really appreciate the opportunity.
Ladies and gentlemen, this has been His Excellency, the High Commissioner to Jamaica, and Mr. Seth George Ramakan. And he will, you've heard him say it, he will join us again at another date.
Certainly,
thank you ever so
I
much.
Will.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Right, we do have to take another break. I understand we have another Jamaican gorgeous fellow outside. He goes by the name of Mr. Levi Roots. Pepper, pepper sauce. Everybody knows that. See you soon.